Hey everybody, this is Tracy here with another edition of A View from Tracy's Point, and we are here to recap Insecure Season 3, Episode 1, which was titled Better Like. Almost forgotten that, well, actually, I did forget that Insecure is only like 30, 35 minutes long, and so it always feels like this episode goes by in like 5 minutes. So, this recap shouldn't take that long, right? So, the show picks up, and it's been like 2 weeks since the last season ended. And Issa is still staying with Daniel. Molly is still with Dro, but I think we get confirmation that Dro and his wife are indeed in an open marriage, and she is cool with him seeing Molly. So Molly seems to have a new job or a new business, but I was multitasking and couldn't decipher exactly what is up with her career, because I thought when the show ended last season, she was trying to get on with the Chicago office of the law firm that she works with. So I guess that fell through. She decided to leave the firm, and now she's doing some consulting or something on the side, but I wasn't sure. So the show opened up with a mad sex scene that had the viewers thinking that it was Issa and Daniel, you know, that they had reconnected in more ways than one. And then we had Molly, who was lounging on the beach, like she was on some island or somewhere with some random guy who appeared to be nothing more than a boy toy looking for a come up. And he wanted Molly to give him some benefits or give him some PDO time or something. Like I said, I was multitasking, and it just seemed like it was something that was thrown in. And that was one of the things that bothers me about Insecure, is you only have 30, 35 minutes. Do we really need these little random scenes that don't mean anything? So Molly returned from vacation with a renewed will to have a better life, and what she's done the past two seasons. Like, she wants to stop going around, sleeping around. She wants to be in love, get married, and all of that stuff. But she realizes that she's never going to get there with the decisions that she's making. So her and Dro are in bed when his wife calls. And so they had been talking about, they had just had sex. He was going to get up and make some pancakes. So I guess he had spent the night. So he answers the call and lets her know that he is still at Molly's. And so I'm assuming he was talking to the wife, because Molly got all in her feelings at that point. So this leaves her feeling, you know, some kind of way, like, this really isn't what I want. This is just confirmation that Dro is never going to be my man if his wife is okay with me seeing him. So she decides that they can be friends with no sex, or acquaintances who just have sex, and that's all to it. So she wanted boundaries, because this was feeling too much like a dream relationship without the benefits of ever becoming a reality. So I hate to admit this, but I really like Dro and Molly together. They are such a cute couple. They seem to get along, just have like perfect energy, perfect chemistry with each other. But then, like I said, we keep getting these text messages and calls from the wife reminding us that he is a married man. And even after Molly puts down the law, you know, Dro still wants to get up and make pancakes for breakfast. But Molly's like, no, that's not part of the deal. It's either going to be friends or it's going to be sex. Like, you got to make up your mind which one it is. So Dro said he's okay with just the sex part. So Issa and Molly have noted their hesitation to live with each other, which is understandable, because you don't want to ruin a friendship if the living conditions get a little tense. But with Molly being on vacation, I don't understand why she didn't offer to let Issa crash at her place, and just be able to do whatever, just to have some time to herself and to get off of Daniel's couch. So the dynamic between Issa and Molly, always seems kind of like we're friends, but we might be getting at that part where we're growing away from each other, but we're all we have, so we're gonna hang in there together. But it's hard to imagine that Issa legitimately believes that being roommates with Daniel would somehow be less of a volatile situation than her trying to room with Molly if the opportunity was there. It wasn't Issa who was getting her back blown out in the opening scene. No, it was much worse than that. Issa was in the living room laying on the couch listening to Daniel blow somebody else's back out. I mean, like, they was moaning and groaning and oohing and aahing, and I was just like, I would probably gotten up and left and walked out there. And then what type of woman comes to her man's apartment and he has another woman sleeping on the car on the couch who he's had a previous relationship with and still go in the bedroom and have sex with him and make all that doggone noise? Like, Daniel, you might want to check your girl and figure out what she's really about. So he seemed to have like no qualms about bringing the woman in, having sex, or any of that with Issa in the other room, but I think it may have been more so to make Issa jealous. So Issa's phone buzzes, and we learn that she has been driving for Lyft to earn extra money so that she can save up and move out and get her own place. But looks like Daniel told her she could stay for a month, and she only has 2 weeks left, I believe it is. And you guys know how I love to make the comparison. So, if you watch Love Is or follow my recaps on Love Is, you know the whole situation with Yasir and Ruby and how Ruby gave him 6 weeks to stay, get himself together and get his own place. And now he's down to 2 weeks left in that little deal. So, y'all know I be catching it, right? So Daniel has a real bachelor pad because Issa was in the bathroom and it was like a sink, but there was no medicine chest, no mirror over the sink, but on the wall was like one of them hand mirrors. You get the little square mirror and it had like the little handle. One of those was hanging on the wall and Issa was kind of like bent over looking at it like that. I was just like, this is crazy. And then Daniel just walk in on her like he forgot that she lived there. And then I was like, so had the girlfriend left? Or was she still lounging in the bed? What was that all about? So later, the two have a conversation where Issa asked him to give her a heads up the next time so she could avoid the apartment when he has women over. And Daniel, he was acting kind of like, what's the big deal? Like, if you don't care about me and you don't want to be with me, what difference does it make if there's somebody there? But he know that he was just being tyke. But Issa tries to play it off like it's no big deal, that it really was all about respect and how she doesn't want to be there listening to that, and that she thinks it's crazy that he's acting like they've never had an intimate relationship before. And so for him to just be throwing that in her face, it was just mad disrespectful. So back to Issa and her Lyft job. So while Daniel was in the room having sex with the woman and Issa decided to leave, she goes and she picks up this guy, and then the guy gets in the car. As soon as they get ready to drive off, he just vomit all over the back seat of the car. And I'm just like, and I'm sure that happens a lot, but that's gotta be so disgusting. And I meant to call my niece because my niece drives for Uber, but she only does it on the weekends, so I can just imagine the stories that she tells. And then I don't know if you guys read the story about the Uber driver who actually had like a recording device in his car, and he would pick people up at nighttime, like from the club and everything, and then he would record what was going on in the car. But it was more like he wasn't spying on them, but he would engage them in conversations and stuff like that. And then posted, I guess, on it's sort of like YouTube, but it's called Patreon or Patch or something like that. Twitch, maybe. But anyway, somebody saw one of the videos and filed a complaint, and he ended up losing his job, and he lost his channel because all the videos were deleted and everything. But I think a lot of people do that because a friend of mine, actually, every now and then, she sends me links to YouTube channels where people are either like delivering food, doing like Uber Eats, or they're actually Uber drivers, and they're talking about the people that have ridden in the car. And I don't really click on them and look what, you know, look at what's going on, because she sends the link on my phone, and I don't like clicking on a bunch of links from my phone. But anyway, getting back to Miss Issa. So Daniel, we get to meet his sister. I think it was his sister, and she was doing a little girl's hair, and she needed somebody to watch her daughter for her. And so she was trying to figure out who was going to watch the daughter. Was it going to be Issa, or was it going to be Daniel's girlfriend? And so they were having a conversation, and it rolled around to pretty much that she was thinking that Issa really does like Daniel, but they have this thing going on where neither one wants to admit that they like the other. And so she asked Daniel, why would she choose you of all people to want to move into? So then later on, Daniel, you know, engages Issa in a conversation again, you know, basically asking her, like, what's the deal? You know, why did you choose me? Why did you want to come live here? So then Issa, you know, finally she breaks down and she says, because she knew that he would be there for her, I guess, more as a support system. And so Daniel leaves to go out on a date, you know, so instead of bringing the woman to the house, he decides that he'll just leave. So Issa decides that she's going to leave also. So she calls Molly and asks Molly about doing a party lift with her, where they were just going to go around, I guess, picking up random people. And Molly, Dro had been calling her. And so he had called and asked her about, you know, did she close on her deal? And he wanted to take her out and celebrate. And she was kind of excited about it. But then she thought, you know, had second thoughts, like, okay, I told him that we weren't going to do this whole dating and all of this stuff, that it was just going to be about sex. So she decides to go with Issa on the little party lift trip so that she can avoid giving in to Dro, and then she would just have Dro come over later that night. So Issa and Molly are in the car, and the first ride that they pick up was these two girls. And so they were on their way to a theater or a party or something, and they're going to a club, and they didn't even know if they had admittance into the club. And so Issa and Molly, you know, they were trying to engage them, and I think they called Issa auntie, that she reminded them of their auntie or something like that. So when they got out the car, they gave her like a 5-star review, said that the music in the car was good, but they didn't leave a tip. And I think that most Uber drivers or people that do any of those kind of service jobs, they really make their money off the tips. I have a friend that delivers groceries, and she says that she can easily make like $1,000 a month just off of tips, you know, going to grocery shop for people and delivering their groceries for them. So after the girls get out, Molly insists that, you know, their next person that they pick up needs to be a good looking man. And so they eventually get one, and his name was Nathan. So Nathan was acting a little weird. I couldn't figure out. I thought maybe he was going to turn out to be like a celebrity or something. But he was, you know, kind of like bashing L.A. And so Issa was telling him that you couldn't get in her car and bash L.A., so we weren't going to do that. And then she asked him for his phone, but he wouldn't give it to her. But then Molly ended up getting the phone. And so he wanted to go get something to eat. So Molly found him another place to eat. He wanted to go to some place called Saddle Ranch. So on the way, they end up picking up another guy who started smoking weed in the car. And when the guy refused to stop, the Nathan guy, like, gave him a serious beat down in the back seat of Issa's car. You know, Issa's car ain't that big. And so to put this into perspective for you guys, the Nathan guy probably was maybe 5'10", 5'11", probably weighed about 180 pounds. And then the guy who was smoking the weed that he done just straddled and beat up probably was about, I don't know, just visualize Biggie Smalls, the rapper. Picture him in the car and with this little dude, but the little dude got the best of him. So Molly was telling Issa, move on, pull over, park the car. And Issa kept on driving, talking about, I can't, there's nowhere to park. So then finally Molly got her to pull over. And when they pull over, the Nathan guy jumps out of the car and, you know, says that he gotta go. So I'm thinking, okay, does he have like a criminal record, or was he really a celebrity and he just didn't want to be caught up in a situation that got into the news or whatever? And then Big Boy, you know, he rolled out the car crying and carrying on because he had to get beat up by this little guy. So at this point, Issa was sure that she was just going to get the money for the actual ride itself, which wouldn't have been that much because they hadn't gone that far. So, you know, she thinks she's seen the last of him, but then later on, she's laying on the couch and she pulls out her phone. I think she got like a notification, and it was a, they were notifying her that Nathan had sent her a $50 tip. And so then she looked at, and I think her whole balance for however long she's been driving was only like $174, or who knows, maybe that whole trip was $174, including that $50. But however it was looking, I don't think she's going to be able to move out of Daniel's place in 2 weeks as agreed upon. And then also at this point, when the tip came in, everyone on Twitter was hoping that Nathan becomes a regular on the show, because you guys know that Lawrence isn't going to be on this season. They've decided to eliminate his character because that season in Issa's life is over with. And you know, when you break up with somebody, like how often do you actually see that person? So there really is no need to have him as a reoccurring role on the show. So let's go over to Issa's real job. So she is still working for that company called We Got Y'all. So Issa, you know, she's been taken out of the field because remember the whole situation with the school that her and the white girl were working at the previous year, and she got mad because Issa wouldn't report the principal for making what she thought were racist comments. Frida, that's her name. So one of the co-workers comes up to Issa and gives Issa this list and tell her that she needs to do callbacks. So I don't know if Frida had told the other woman to do it and she was passing it on to Issa, or if Frida was afraid to ask Issa to do it, so she had a go-between to bring the paper to Issa and tell Issa she had to make the calls. But then later on, Frida kind of like is trying to spy on Issa to make sure she's making the phone calls. And Issa lets her know that she just started and she'd only done one call, so she hadn't had a chance to F up yet. So during the calls, Issa decides that she's going to start asking like the schools that had already quit, because that's what the whole callback was for. They were losing all of their accounts, and so they wanted to call the people that hadn't canceled yet to see, you know, what they could do to better help them. But then Issa decided to call the people who had canceled to find out why they weren't coming back, and so she found out that the people thought that the logo for We Got Y'all was racist, because it's like, it's a black and white image, but the people are black, the kids are black, and then the hand that they're standing in is a white hand. So it's implying that white people got to come in and save these minority students. Then they were saying that they were offended that they only had one black employee on the staff, but their schools are predominantly black students. So Issa, you know, like, okay, I'm gonna go and let them know that this is the issue. Y'all need some more diversity in here. But instead, it backfires, and Joanne is really upset that Issa, instead of calling the people they told her to call, that she was calling these other people. And Issa, you know, was like, I was just being proactive, but they told her she was overstepping her boundaries. And then Frida was just sitting there like, oh my God, like, do I challenge Joanne and get fired or get demoted? Or do I lose my friendship with Issa because I'm sitting here being a coward and not standing up for her? But they basically told her to go back to her desk and mind her own business. And while she's sitting there, figure out why every time something comes up within the company, Issa is always behind it, that she has something to do with it. So basically, they want her to go sit down, shut up, don't say anything, and let them destroy them on their own selves. So we have a scene with Molly, and she is getting ready to go to bed. And I actually think that this was the night that her and Issa had did the party lift. And so remember, Dro was supposed to come over, but he was only supposed to be coming over for sex. So Molly's in the I think she was in her bedroom and she was like trying to decide what she wanted to put on, and she was like holding the bra up and everything. So she visually figures out what she wants to do. And then when she comes into the living room, and I guess she was getting ready for Jerome. Jerome was already there. He was sitting at the bar, had to pull them some glasses of wine and everything. And so she's like, "What are you doing? Like, how did you get here?" And Drew like really missed the part about it was only going to be about sex. Like, he still thinks they have this thing going on. And so he tells Molly, you know, he used his key to get in. So Molly tells him that she wants her key back. So the two get into a back and forth, and Molly was, you know, pretty much saying that she didn't like the whole thing about him being married, and that, you know, him and his wife have their thing going on, but where does that leave her? And Dro got all offended and everything because she had brought up the wife and was like, what me and my wife got going on is really none of your business. What you need to be focusing on is what it is that you want. And so Molly was so outdone that all she could say, well, what I want is to have my key back. And so he gave her that key back, but he had an attitude and he stormed out. So I don't know if that's the last we're going to see of Drew or what's going on with that situation. So the last scene of the show, we have Daniel and Issa, and they are having a conversation. And I actually think I may have messed this up earlier, but I didn't mess it up too much, but I'll go ahead and tell you. So they're having the conversation. He decides to finally ask Issa the same question that the sister asked them, which was, why did you come here? And so Issa, you know, was basically saying that she felt that she had a support system there. And earlier when he asked her, why did she move in with him? She said because it was closer to work. So now she's like trying to be a little more open, but not open enough. And then Daniel is being kind of sarcastic and he won't say. So it was obvious that they had like a tug of war going on where they really want to be together, but they're afraid to be the one to say that they want to be together for fear of rejection. And so we don't know how this whole dynamic is going to work out. But the show ends with Daniel giving her the apartment for the night. And I guess he was going to spend the night with his boo. So guys, that's it for me. If I messed something up, which I think I did, I think I missed the order of the conversations with Daniel and Issa. So if you remember what they were, leave it in the comments. If there's anything you want to add to it, leave that as well. Rate the video, subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already. And until the next time, I shall talk to you guys later. Bye-bye.